morning and welcome to midweek Lenten worship for Wednesday, March 24, 2021. Tonight we present the last of our five midweek Lenten worship services. Next week is Holy Week. We'll have a live streaming Maundy Thursday service on the YouTube channel at 7 p.m. And then we'll have a Good Friday service that will be available to you early on Friday. And then we'll gather for Easter Sunday worship on April 4 at the Mandalay Banquet and Event Center with services at 9 and 11. You'll need to register in advance, and details on that can be found in the Wave. Tonight, we look at the fifth lesson from the Passion History. I hope that you've derived some meaning from this look at all four Gospels' accounts of Jesus' suffering and resurrection. And now let's worship. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Let your people sing with joy. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Lord, keep this nation under your care and guide us in the way of justice and truth. Let your way be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and sustain us with your Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. Let's pray. Almighty God, your Son, Jesus Christ, was lifted high upon the cross, so that he might draw the whole world to himself. Grant that we who glory in his death for our salvation may also glory in his call to take up our cross and follow him. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Two other men who were criminals were led away with Jesus to be executed. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. They offered him wine to drink mixed with gall, but when he tasted it, he would not drink it. They crucified him there with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Now it was the third hour when they crucified him. Pilate also had a notice written and fastened on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this notice because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write, 'The King of the Jews,' but that 'This man said, I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier. They also took his tunic, which was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, "Let's not tear it. Instead, let's cast lots to see who gets it." This was so that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, "They divided my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing." So the soldiers did these things. Then they sat down and were keeping watch over him there. People who passed by kept insulting him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who were going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." Those who were crucified with him also insulted him. In the same way, the chief priests, experts in the law, and elders kept mocking him. They said, "He saved others, but he cannot save himself. If he's the King of Israel, let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him, because he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" One of the criminals hanging there was blaspheming him, saying, "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him, "Don't you fear God, since you are under the same condemnation? We are punished justly, for we are receiving what we deserve for what we have done. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come in your kingdom."
Jesus said to him, "Amen, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Jesus' mother, his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene were standing near the cross. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time, this disciple took her into his own home. It was now about the sixth hour, and darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour, while the sun was darkened. At the ninth hour, Jesus shouted in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing there heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." After this, knowing that everything had now been finished and to fulfill the scripture, Jesus said, "I thirst." A jar full of sour wine was sitting there. Immediately one of them ran, took a sponge, and soaked it with the sour wine. Then he put it on a stick and gave it him a drink. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Suddenly the temple curtain was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and rocks were split. Tombs were opened, and many bodies of saints who had fallen asleep were raised to life. Those who came out of the tombs went into the holy city after Jesus' resurrection and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those who were guarding Jesus with him saw the earthquake and how he cried out with a loud voice and breathed his last, they were terrified and began to glorify God, saying, "This man really was righteous. Truly, this was the Son of God." When all of the groups of people who had gathered to see the spectacle saw what had happened, they returned home beating their chest. All those who knew Jesus and many women who had followed Jesus from Galilee and who had served him were there, watching from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, Salome, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. Since it was the preparation day, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the crosses over the Sabbath, because that Sabbath was a particularly important day. They asked Pilate to have the men's legs broken and the bodies taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first man who was crucified with Jesus, and then those of the other man. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear. Immediately blood and water came out. The one who saw it has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is telling the truth, so that he also may believe. Indeed, these things happen so that the scripture would be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. Again, another scripture says, they will look at the one they pierced.
When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was also a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews. Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council, was a good and righteous man. He had not agreed with their plan and action. He was looking forward to the kingdom of God. He boldly went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was surprised that Jesus was already dead. He summoned the centurion and asked him if Jesus had been dead for a long time. When he learned from the centurion that it was so, he granted the body to Joseph. Joseph bought a linen cloth, came and took Jesus' body away. Nicodemus, who earlier had come to Jesus at night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 72 pounds. They took Jesus' body and bound it with linen straps along with the spices, in accord with Jewish burial customs. There was a garden at the place where Jesus was crucified, and in the garden was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. So they laid Jesus there. Because it was the Jewish preparation day, and the tomb was near, Joseph took the body and laid it in his own new tomb that he had cut in the rock. He rolled a large stone over the tomb's entrance and left. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed after Joseph, and they observed the tomb and how Jesus' body was laid there. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, were watching where the body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and perfumes. On the Sabbath they rested according to the commandment. On the next day, which was the day after the preparation day, the chief priests and Pharisees gathered in the presence of Pilate and said, "Sir, we remembered what that deceiver said while he was still alive. After 3 days I will rise again. So give a command that the tomb be made secure until the third day. Otherwise his disciples might steal his body and tell the people he has risen from the dead. And this last deception will be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard. Go, make it as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone and posting a guard.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we look to Jesus on the cross, help us to see our only hope and our only salvation. Father, we further ask that you will use these words to bring glory to you. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. It's a funny thing about our world that we associate certain furnishings with people who wield power and influence, people who can make a difference in the life of the world. Throughout history, kings have had thrones. British prime ministers show their power when they emerge from the front door at 10 Downing Street. American presidents sit behind impressive desks in the Oval Office at the White House. Popes use St. Peter's Basilica in Vatican City. The furnishings given to such public figures cause billions around the world to pay attention to them, to attach authority to their words and their decisions. On the other hand, there are people whose attire or furnishings or places of residence convey that they are without influence or power or the capacity to make any difference in anyone's life. A condemned man sitting in an electric chair, for example, isn't someone who instills awe or a belief that he can do anything helpful for the world. This is why something mentioned in tonight's installment of the Passion History, coming to us from Luke chapter 23, verses 39 to 43, is so odd. Jesus, his body already battered and bleeding from the physical and emotional abuse to which he's been subjected, is nailed to a cross between two thieves. Crucifixion, as you know, was a humiliating, painful, and drawn-out means of execution. The victims of crucifixion often took days to die, usually succumbing to suffocation as they could no longer arch their bodies away from the nooses put around their necks when they were attached to their crosses. It's hard to imagine anyone less likely to inspire awe or worship than a man on a cross. This explains why in Luke 23, verse 35, we read that the religious leaders of the Jewish nation sneered at Jesus and said, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." It's also why we're told in Luke 23, verse 36, the Roman soldiers also came up and mocked him. Jesus had called himself God's Messiah. He had accepted worship from people who proclaimed him God in human flesh. But now, his friends having largely abandoned, betrayed, or denied him, Jesus is alone, enduring the humiliation and death of a Roman cross. No wonder people were taunting him. According to Mark's gospel, even the two criminals who hung on their own crosses, one on Jesus' right and the other on his left, joined in taunting Jesus. But Luke tells us about something else involving those two. Luke 23, verse 39 tells us, one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at Jesus. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." In the Greek language in which Luke composed his gospel, the two criminals are literally called kakurgon, a compound word that means evil workers or evil doers. In other words, the two men being executed alongside Jesus are professional criminals, people so given over to evil that they're in the habit of only looking out for themselves. That comes through in the mocking words of the first criminal. "Hey," he's saying, "if you really are the Messiah, get us off these crosses." His words echo those of the devil, spoken to Jesus when Jesus was being tempted by the devil in the wilderness. "If you are the Son of God," the devil said, "command this stone to become bread. Worship me to have the kingdoms of the world you came to claim. Throw yourself down from the pinnacle of the temple." Jesus, through his words and signs and compassion, had demonstrated his identity repeatedly. He was and is God the Son. But for a cynical world intent on being their own gods and ignoring Jesus' call to repent and follow him, nothing Jesus did or said would ever be enough. So the first criminal railed against Jesus. Literally, Luke says he blasphemed Jesus. He slandered Jesus. He profaned Jesus' good name. We can say that that first criminal was profaning Jesus' good name because even Herod, the Jewish king, and Pilate, the Roman governor, had found Jesus completely innocent. "I have found in him no grounds for the death penalty," Pilate had said. But, innocent or not, a cross doesn't look much like a president's desk or a king's throne. Yet Luke tells us that the other criminal, the other evildoer, as he observed Jesus being crucified with him, came to view Jesus differently. Verse 40. But the other criminal rebuked the first one. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." And then he turns to Jesus to offer a prayer, a request. "Jesus," he says, "remember me when you come into your kingdom." Listen, when anyone is able to believe in the good news that Jesus Christ, truly God and truly human, died and rose so that all who repent and believe in him will live with God in his kingdom for all eternity. When that happens, when faith comes to a person, it is a miracle created by the Holy Spirit. Martin Luther writes in the Small Catechism, "I believe that I cannot, by my own reason or strength, believe in Jesus Christ or come to him. But the Holy Spirit has called me through the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, and sanctified and preserved me in true faith." Faith is always a miracle of the Holy Spirit. And while faith is a free gift from God, it is not easy. Earlier in Luke's gospel, we read Jesus describing what it means to be his disciple. "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross." That is, they must acknowledge their mortality and their sin and their need of Jesus to live and for Jesus to save them. And Jesus says we need to do that daily and follow him. Here, on a cross, a hardened criminal took up his cross, admitting that he was a sinner who deserved to die, yet seeing in Jesus forgiveness of sin from God for all who repent, and new life that never ends for those who trust in the Savior. At that moment, that hardened criminal became one of Jesus' disciples. And do you know what disciples are? They're people who have come to the end of themselves and recognize that their only hope every single day is to be found in Jesus Christ alone. They're the people who keep coming back to the Savior, where they know they will find forgiveness and new life. But what was it that the Holy Spirit did that day to show the second criminal the truth about Jesus, the truth that drove him to repentance and faith in Jesus? I think it was this. He saw a sinless Savior who had previously demonstrated his power over life and death even raising people from the dead, who laid his own glory aside in order to take the punishment for our sins that you and I deserve. The second criminal saw God's infinite and inexhaustible love for a human race that doesn't deserve it. He saw a love that can transform each of us from enemies indifferent to God to God's dear children. The Apostle Paul says that the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, like the first criminal. But to us who are being saved, like the second criminal, it is the power of God. Jesus, in Jesus' selfless death for him and all the other sinners of the world, including you and me, the second criminal saw the power of God to save sinners, to destroy the power of sin and death over all who take up their cross and follow Jesus. It becomes theirs because Jesus has taken all of their sin and their death into his own body and killed it for all eternity. So that as he is raised, those who cast their lot with him have the resurrection victory that was given to Jesus by God the Father on the first Easter Sunday. As we look to Jesus today, may the Holy Spirit help us see the same thing that second criminal saw, that Jesus died for sinners like you and me. Jesus does not need basilicas or thrones or oval offices to prove his authority over sin and death, or to provide for us in our deepest need. He's done all that through his cross. May we, like the second criminal, be led to understand that it is worth bearing the cross of our mortality, sin, and desperate need of God to follow Jesus into eternity. To all who daily repent and believe in Jesus, Jesus promises, as he did to the thief, that one day we too will be with him in paradise. Amen. Let's pray. We give thanks to you, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have this day so graciously protected us. We beg you to forgive us all our sins and the wrong which we have done. By your great mercy, defend us from all the perils and dangers of this night. Into your hands we commend our bodies and souls and all that is ours. Let your holy angels have charge of us, that the wicked one have no power over us. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Lord bless us, defend us from all evil, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen.